development. My name is Mitch Ashley, and I'll serve as your host and moderator for the webinar. A few housekeeping items. The webinar is being recorded, and the recording and slides will be available following the webinar, both on devops.com. We'll also send out an email with links to the content. We highly encourage questions from the audience. Our speakers love questions, so please submit those into the GoToWebinar control panel under the Questions tab. So now let's move on to our topic, optimizing workflow for software development. It's my pleasure to introduce our first speaker, Jeff Kies, who's Director of Product Marketing at Plutora. Jeff, thank you for joining us and kicking us off on the webinar. I'll turn it over to you.
That's fantastic. Thanks, Mitch. I'm excited for these conversations. We have a series of webinars that we've been doing together, and I want to introduce Gary Gruver, which really needs no introduction. We have as the title slide here a copy of an image of Gary's latest book about engineering the digital transformation. We're going to talk more about that and aspects of that. What's exciting about today is you have the opportunity to hear firsthand from Gary, who's got a long history of experience in dealing with transformational projects and coaching enterprises through improving their application delivery through all types of development styles, methodologies, architectures, and so forth, and how software is delivered. And so with that, I'm just going to turn the time over to Gary and make sure you utilize your time here by getting your questions into the question panel. You know, funny enough, just a quick story, how I met Gary was actually on LinkedIn and popped a couple questions to him that he responded to. And we had a fascinating conversation. That's how I knew I was going to really enjoy working with Gary for the long term. And now he's an advisor to Plutora and helping us work together. The reason why Plutora and Gruver Consulting are together is because Gary is all about helping companies transform and improve application delivery. And Plutora is a platform that helps you implement that. So with that, Gary, I'm going to turn the time over to you. Take us away.
Great, Jeff. Thanks. Great to be here, and thanks for the great introduction. Software is becoming more and more important to how a broad range of companies compete. There's some companies like Amazon and Google that are developing and delivering software to the rate that nobody ever thought possible and are starting to dominate broad parts of the market. But there's also a lot of legacy groups that have been around. And in fact, the majority of software is not that efficient and that effective at developing and delivering software. From my perspective, it really reminds me of what happened in the automobile industry in the 70s and 80s. All of a sudden, Toyota was developing cars with much higher quality and better efficiencies than anybody ever thought possible. And it really had the U.S. automobile industry on their back trying to figure out how they're going to respond and how they're going to compete. They started off by trying to understand the processes that were being used and trying to implement those in their organizations. They went off on trying to benchmark as much as they could what the companies were doing that were making them effective and copying those processes. And they spent years and years with that approach and found that it really wasn't working that well. And in fact, Toyota would let whoever of their competitors come in and benchmark their processes whenever they wanted because they realized that their competitive advantage was not how the process worked today. Their competitive advantage was their approach to continuous improvement. And they did it in such a way that it was everybody's job to be thinking about how to improve how they did everything about their business. And they had a structured approach to continuous improvement. And eventually the U.S. automobile industry caught on to that. That structured approach at Toyota is called the Kata process. As they rolled it across the broader U.S. industry, it's Lean Six Sigma type of approach. And it's a structured methodology that can engage the entire organization looking for waste and inefficiencies and motivating them to continually improve how they manufacture and develop automobiles. And I think the software industry is at a similar state. You know, people have seen what has been able to be accomplished with Agile in small companies and in large companies. And people went off and said, well, I need to do Agile, so I want to copy that process. And then they realized that these same organizations were struggling with the Agile principle of how do I get the code to my customers on an ongoing basis. And DevOps came along and people really started focusing in on copying those processes. And then we got much better at benchmarking where people are on their DevOps journey and what the best companies are doing. And what I've started to realize is, as I work with more and more clients, as we just try to implement those processes and those approaches that we've seen in other companies, we're not improving as quick and efficiently as we possibly could. And I've come to the conclusion that similar to where it was in the automobile industry, we need a structured approach for driving continuous improvement that can engage the entire organization. And we can't just copy what was done in manufacturing because software is a very different beast. We need to fine-tune it to address unique challenges of software, but we need something that is a systematic approach that we can share across the organization, that people can work together on common concepts and ideas. And that's the latest focus of my work, is how do we get a more structured approach to figuring out how to drive these improvements, how to make these improvements happen. And that's the focus of my latest book, Engineering the Digital Transformation. That's the focus of this webinar series. We started in June with kind of an overview of how to drive that improvement with engineering rigor. And then in July, we really laid out that depending on the application, depending on the architecture, depending on whether you own the deployment process or not, really defines how you go after improving the process and how you go after removing waste and inefficiency. You need to understand the problem you're trying to solve. And we start that by making the architecture and the process visible and then mapping it out. And what we learned in manufacturing early on is that you really can't have a very efficient approach to developing and delivering anything in manufacturing if you don't build in quality. And that's a really different focus than typically been there for software. In software, we've had this habit of batching up large amounts of inventory and inspecting in quality at the end game. If we're going to fundamentally transform how we do software development and become much more productive and more efficient, one of the first steps is building in quality. This week, we're really going to focus on, and now that we've understood how the basics of building a product, how to improve flow and productivity across our software development pipeline. October, we're going to go more into continuous improvement. And as we go into future months, we're going to fine tune and continue to deliver on this message of the steps and the approaches that you need to drive a systematic approach to continuous improvement in your organization, starting with laying this framework. When we look at flow and we look historically, one of the best examples is Henry Ford. Henry Ford created a linked assembly line where he was able to make automobiles affordable for the masses because he was able to manufacture them in such an efficient way. He was able to go from raw iron ore on one end of the factory to complete cars within 81 hours. And he did that by having everything on a linked assembly line. And he had a limited amount of space, so there really wasn't room for defects and rework. And there wasn't anything that slowed down the flow or wasn't getting the automobiles out at the rate that it needed to be anywhere in this line became very obvious because the line would stop. People could swarm on it, fix the issues, and go through that. And it is still the model of efficiency, but it was the model of efficiency for building one thing in high volume, and you could have any color you wanted as long as it was black. And for that type of process and that type of approach, what you're trying to design, this manufacturing process was and still is the model for efficiencies on how to manufacture that. And it was focused on how to limit inventory in the system and how to make any issues that are causing a slowdown in flow obvious to everybody in the organization so you could focus on it. It also included things later that Toyota created that they really focused on the Andon cord. And this was a process where anytime you saw a problem, a quality problem or an issue with the process, you could pull the cord and stop the line and make sure that the process got fixed because it was a process that was creating the product. Now that's different in software. In software, it's not the process that's creating the product. It's individual coders that are working on different things. And then software, we don't need to stop the line to build in quality. We can do that with quality gates. The classic example is gating code going into the SCM. If you have a Git repository or you're using Git, they call it code gating. When we first did it a decade ago at HP, it was called auto reverse. But this was the idea that I don't need to stop the line and I don't need to back up all the good code that's trying to come down the line because I had some bad code make it. What I can do is I can take that build that had the bad code in it, I can send it back to the developer and have them work on getting it fixed immediately. And then I can open that quality gate back up and continue to keep good code flowing through the organization. So this idea of I need to have a red build, I need to stop the line, really doesn't apply. What we can do is we can take that code, send it back to the developer, and the code just doesn't make it to trunk until it's proven that it's at a sufficient level of quality with our quality gates to do that. And that's fundamentally different with software. And if you've got a large complex system with a lot of subcomponents and different things that built up that need to be integrated and tested as a system, you can really look at having quality gates at different phases and different stages. And with this, what we're trying to do is we're trying to improve the flow as much as we can. So we're testing all these components together, but at the same time, we're trying to keep the defective code from getting into our QA environments or UIT environments. So those are much more stable and we can use those on an ongoing basis. And that by doing that, we're able to manage the flow. Whereas if you were to just have a red build or stop the build or let a bad subsystem get into your QA environment, then you've got to deal with the triage. It's much harder to localize it to a few number of developers. So a lot of what we're doing to build in quality really helps us optimize the flow. And Henry Ford did this by optimizing the flow because he had limited space for rework. So you couldn't have defects piling up in the system that had to be reworked later. And it was very obvious anytime there was a problem with flow. And this worked really well for very high volume manufacturing, building one thing. But when you went into a factory like this and you had a bunch of different machines that were building different products and different things at different rates, it was much harder to tell how to make things efficient. And the initial starts that they tried to do to drive efficiencies into this was trying to make sure all of these manufacturing stations were always busy. So we always wanted work out there that people could be doing. And what we learned is that ended up driving a very inefficient approach to manufacturing. You ended up building up a lot of inventory in the system and you couldn't see where you had issues with the flow and where you had problems. Dr. Goldratt came in on this and really focused in on theory of constraints. And the idea here was that we have one constraint in the process, typically, that's driving the flow through the organization. And that if we try to keep everybody busy, we end up building up way too much inventory in the system. We're not getting throughput through. And he came up with his goal of 5 focusing steps to improve flow through the organization. And this started by understanding the system constraint. In a manufacturing process, you'll typically have one step, one machine. The goal, the classic one is, I think it was a paint drying machine that they had that was slowing down things in the process. And what he did is he'd go to that and he'd try to figure out, okay, that process can only process so many products per cycle time. Maybe you do a batch of 10 products going through the drying machine and it takes an hour to do, so you know that you do 10 parts per hour. Maybe you've got a manufacturing facility. So in this type of thing, you figure out where the bottleneck is the system and what's slowing it down. And then you decide how to exploit the system. Can I have people working overtime on that machine? Can I get that same function done on a different machine? How do I do that? And then you subordinate everything else to those decisions. You try to figure out how to make that constraint visible to everybody. Everybody focuses on how to remove that constraint in the process. And then as you do that, if the constraint has been broken, then you go back up to step number 1 and start over. but don't allow the inertia to cause a constraint to continue. And that focus on throughput, manufacturing organizations that did that and studied it and spent their time on it, realized that they were seeing a 70% increase in efficiencies with the same people and the same equipment. If you could get a 70% improvement in your efficiencies in your organization, do you think your business could find things to do that would make you more competitive in the market? If you're like most of my clients, you're not in a position of lacking ideas or processes. The other thing that's unique about manufacturing is because they only manufacture one product at a time or one part at a time, it was very important in the manufacturing process to focus in on the constraint. But in software, the manufacturing process of software in terms of create an environment, build the code, deploy the code, and run the tests takes the same amount of time and energy to do for one line of code changes as it does for 100,000 lines of code changes. Because of that, the tendency in software has been to batch up large amounts of inventory and then inspect in quality. And this has really been especially the way things were done when there was a lot of manual testing in the system. But as we go to more automating and we go to more DevOps principles of being able to automate that environment, the deployment process, and testing, we find that, you know, the constraint in the system changes. It typically starts out here in this, you know, build, create environment, deploy and test, even though I can do a batch as quick as anything else. But then it can quickly move. Once you've got that set up, what you start to realize is that the constraint for most organizations isn't always necessarily the time it takes to test. It's the time it takes to triage and fix all the defects. And that's why we want to really focus in on building in quality. And when we look at this, the way to make that triage and defect fixing much more efficient is we go to much smaller batch sizes. So we have to evaluate different numbers of changes and do that. It can move over into operations where they're monitoring it. But I think the Google SRE team taught us a very good lesson with their book, How Google Does SRE. I can't remember the exact title, but if you haven't read it and then you're in this industry, you should definitely read that book. But what they did and put in place is these teams in Google can move as fast as they want, creating, building, deploying, and putting stuff into productions as long as they meet their service level agreements. As soon as that service level agreement is broken, then they have to focus on getting that production environment more stable and figuring out how to keep it stable and improving their deployment pipeline so they're not putting quality issues out. For them, they put that as a control or a quality gate on operations, whereas if the team gets too out of control and is pushing too much, that process and approach and authority to shut down the development teams and make them fix it has enabled operations not to be the bottleneck. But, you know, ideally, a lot of large organizations start with it in the create the environment, build the manufacturing of code issues. But the good news is with a lot of DevOps, we've been able to automate that and make it more efficient. As we go to smaller batch sizes, it kind of moves over into the triage. And as we get that to smaller batch sizes, we want to focus on making that more efficient. And then the bottleneck can either be on the business idea of the developer. Some people say it should be on the business idea, but having been in a lot of large organizations, I would say if it sits with the business idea for very long, the organization's probably going to go through a right-sizing type of effort. So realistically, the best place to have the bottleneck is on the developer. And then as we try to keep from building up too much inventory in the system, we need a pull type of system that really pulls work into the system based on when the developer's ready. And that becomes our bottleneck, and that's how we manage and plan work and release work into the system. And we'll cover that in one of our future webinars when we go much more into the planning process. So understanding the constraint in software is important. The other thing that's unique and challenging for software is that in manufacturing, we're building the same thing over and over and over again. It's really easy to measure how many units are coming down the line per second, per minute, per hour, per day, per month. And we can run experiments to improve the efficiencies of that. We can run experiments to run the effectiveness of that. We can measure the change that we made. We can use a scientific method to figure out whether it got better or not. The challenge with software is the flow is really hard to measure. Each feature, each process is a different size. It's a different shape. When I make a change, I don't know if I'm processing something bigger or smaller. So it's very hard to measure the flow for software. And this is why, as I started my career driving these things and starting to consult, what I've been coaching executives is they need to spend time out in the organization getting a qualitative feel for what's slowing things down and what's not. That's what I did at HP. I would go in each morning, I'd spend my first hour from 7 to 8 understanding exactly what's going on in my organization, because I had very good metrics to understand the quality, I had very good metrics to understand the flow, and I'd spend my time out in the organization figuring out what was getting in the way and what wasn't getting in the way. As I've been coaching organizations and executives over the last 5 or 6 years, what I've started to realize is that's hard to replicate. I have a hard time getting executives out there spending the time and effort doing that. And I've also started to realize that the value that having good metrics in a large organization can provide. If you can provide good metrics that enable you to measure things, large organizations have gotten very effective at driving change and driving efficiencies into their organization. But this is hard to do. If you're going to measure flow, do you measure lines of code turmoil? You don't want to do that. People start copying and pasting. Do you want to measure story points? We could do that. But if you really wanted to be more effective at doing that, and I've got a manager telling me I need to be more productive, I can break a story point into whatever granularity I want to show the productivity that you need. From the perspective of measuring flow, it's really, to me, come down to tell me how you're going to measure me and I'll tell you how I'm going to play the game. And that's why I focused on figuring out, how to get that qualitative feel. But what I've started to realize as I've worked with more and more different organizations and focused on it is, while I can't measure flow, I can measure waste that's slowing down flow. We can prioritize those things and we can see the difference it makes. For example, take an environment somewhere on your path of your deployment pipeline, you can do a Pareto chart of issues. In this case, we're really not ready to start building in quality because the types of things we're having to debug and triage are all related to things outside the developer's control. We may have tests that are unstable. We may have tests that are hard to maintain. We need to address those issues because what we're trying to do with tests is not create the best tests in the world. We're trying to create tests that find all our code issues and make sure that we have good quality. And if the majority of our time is going into fixing, debugging, and triaging test issues, that's waste and inefficiencies in the system. And we need to design our automation different and start using it different. If we're finding primarily environment issues, then we need to make sure we get our environments under control. And it may be, back-end systems that are causing instability that you need to use service virtualization to mock out so that you can ensure that you're creating stability and your peace of the world. Or it may be environment configuration issues, and we need to look at making sure that we have our environments under source control management. We're maybe doing Docker containers if we can have that, but we're managing that, and that we're automating our deployment issues. Those are the types of things that DevOps has taught us that we can make more consistent, we can make more reliable, and anytime we're debugging and triaging those issues, that's waste that we can identify in the organization. There's things that we can go do and implement to fix that waste, and then we can go track and see that it had an improvement. And one of the biggest challenges was getting a transformation going and keeping people engaged is, one, you need to get people to commit to investing a certain part of the capacity in continuous improvement of the processes and approaches. And this is different in manufacturing because in manufacturing, we have one group that designs a product to be manufactured efficiently. And then we have another group that manufactures it that's very focused on improving the flow and building in quality, because that defines the productivity of our organization. In software, it's different because we're doing the manufacturing of the software as we do development, and the process that we use for manufacturing the software defines the productivity of the product development. So we need to do both at the same time with the same team. And if we're going to convince people not to build up massive amounts of technical debt, and we're going to convince people to invest in these process changes that will make the organization more efficient over time, or as I like to say, commit a certain percent of your capacity to sharpening the saw as opposed to constantly cutting with the saw, we're going to need to make these wastes and inefficiencies visible to the broader part of the organization so they can invest. And then once they've made an investment, you're going to need to go back to them and show them the waste and inefficiencies that you've taken out of the organization based on the investment that you've made. And for me, that's one of the biggest challenges, is being able to get and continue to maintain your continuous improvement process, is getting people to invest at that level. And if you can't show the waste and you can't show the impact of your changes, you're going to have a hard time maintaining momentum. One of the types of things that we see is these types of issues that can be automated and fixed once and for all. Anytime I've got to go in and debug and triage and look at them at all, that's waste and inefficiencies that's slowing down the organization. The next thing that we need to look at is flow is one, how long does it take to go from a code check-in and into production? And the other piece of this is, where are we finding the defects? We can't build in quality, and we can't expect anybody to get better at doing development if we've got a situation like this organization does, where, you know, it takes 4 weeks to get the code into QA and they're finding 60% of their defects there. If we get into this type of situation, we're going to somebody and we're beating them up for something they don't even remember doing. And by the way, I've got to triage the last 4 weeks of work from everybody working on all these different applications to see what the issue is. And to take waste and inefficiencies out of this system, we need to think about gating our code further up, doing more of our testing this way, and improving the flow through the organization. For this is the building in quality that we talked about in the last webinar, and really this focus on gating code and finding the issues as close to the developers as we possibly can. And that drive helps to make them much more efficient and effective. One of the things that we've got to watch when we do this is some organizations get so good at understanding their subsystems and gating that code that they tend to build up a lot of steps. Boy, I remember the last release I got bit by this. So we're going to go back to our process and we're going to add gates or decisions. And when I looked at this, and when I first started doing this with organizations I ran, the flow of code into these different environments was really driven by the amount of time it took to create an environment, deploy the code, and test the code. As I started working with more and more organizations, what I started to realize is most organizations, the flow down their deployment pipeline was defined by their product lifecycle, which is to say they would have people writing on working on code for an extended period of time, and it wouldn't make it into the QA environment until they met a milestone like development complete. And they did that because they didn't want the QA organization wasting a lot of time doing very expensive manual testing on code that wasn't ready. The problem we have with that is we end up with code up here that never interacts with code down here, so we don't see the interactions between the subsystems until very late, and we end up with a big delay in the feedback. As we've automated testing, we've made that more efficient, and we've created quality gates, we can use that test automation and quality gates to make sure that we're optimizing flow and getting it through on a more regular basis. And that's a fundamental difference. And we need to use our automated testing to change the efficiencies of the organization by building in quality and working through those things. And if you can do a very good job of looking at the cycle time, how long does it take code to flow through from checked in to production? Look at what's driving that. Is that technology or is that inherent processes in your system? And then look at the delay and feedback. A lot of people talk about shifting left with testing, and I think it's more than shifting left with testing. It's yes, you do more of your testing to the left, but you also gate your code and you build in quality as opposed to holding up large batches and different things. And what I've seen large organizations that have done a very good structured job of this, every time they get bit by something in production, they add a new step or they'll add a manual sign off. And what we need to watch for in this situation, if you do that too much, I was working with one large organization that released every 9 months, and they'd done such a good job of creating some automated tests at every stage and every part of this, and you had to be passing at 100% of all your automated testing to ever get it to trunk into these integrated environments. And what they found out was that behavior was forcing people not to come to trunk on a very often basis. So it was a very large, complex system. They released every 9 months, but they would hold their code off at their subsystem level and not integrate it together until right before they were getting ready to release. So all of this code never saw any of this other code. And when they put it together, they found a bunch of defects that they didn't know of. So their efforts to create good quality gates and find everything upstream really delayed the time that it was taking to find the integration between the two things. So as we look at the quality gates, as we look at removing the waste and improving it, we also need to think about the inventory that's building up in the system and what that's doing to our cycle time and flow through our organization and the productivity. In manufacturing, anytime they see inventory, they think of it as waste. They think of it as risk of having to do rework or expediting. In software, we need to do a much better job of making our inventory visible and available to the organization. And the way we need to do that is be able to map on top of our deployment pipeline where we have inventory building up in the system. For example, in this example, QA has got 70,000 lines of code turmoil that hasn't made it into UA staging or production. All that is at risk of finding different issues later. We've got 50,000 lines of code turmoil on subsystem one that hasn't made it into QA. So we're backing up inventory that when we put together is at risk of finding those different types of things. When we look at trying to optimize flow for the organization, we can really go back and look at what are the issues that we can automate and fix once for all that are waste, that are slowing down the flow. Where are we seeing delay in our feedback and where are we seeing our cycle time slow? And then as we look at these types of things and put in gates, we need to understand where inventory is building up in the system and where we're seeing slowdowns in the flow so that the organizations aren't as productive and effective as they possibly could be. And it's this approach of understanding the flow, looking at, you know, this system, understanding where the constraint is, understanding how it moves, understanding how we optimize those things to improve the flow for the organization. This is going to be different for a loosely coupled system where a team of five people can work independently. It's going to be different for a large tightly coupled system where you have hundreds of people working together, but you still own your deployment. It's going to be different for companies that create large package software, they don't own their deployment. And it's going to be very different for embedded software where you've got to deploy on a bunch of different products. You got to do development on simulators and emulators. And as we take a systematic approach to trying and understand how to improve the productivity of the organization, we need to start by understanding our architecture. We need to start by understanding our applications. We need to work to build in quality. And then we need to look at the waste that's slowing down flow, and we need to follow this through the system. And those are the systematic approaches that we can teach everybody in the organization to have a common understanding of. There's metrics that can be common and we can start to look at those. And then we can encourage people to use this process to justify investments, to make changes, to take waste out of the system, and then prove that we become more efficient. Hopefully this has been very helpful for helping you think about it. There's a lot more details in my book. I'm giving away 10 free books to the first people that can go to my website, click on the ebook, and then where it goes to, there's a code that you can enter. And the first 10 people that enter the code of flow will get a free ebook. If you'd like a copy of these slides, you can send an email to slides@gruver.info. And if you have any questions that we don't cover in this chat room and everything else, you can send questions to me later at gary@garygruver.com. And with that, I'm going to hand this back over to Jeff.
Awesome. This is fantastic. Just a bit of why is Plutora here talking about this? We're all in the same boat of trying to improve application delivery, find the constraints, optimize the flow, automate as much as possible. And Plutora is a platform that helps you operationalize that. We, as a platform, we're a SaaS-based solution that integrates into the entirety of your application development, delivery, and operational side. Bringing that data together into the cloud, allowing a converged tool chain, if you will, that relates data from the planning, development, all the way through into operations. As we sit on top of that, we enable companies to drive orchestrations and workflows on top of those tools themselves, optimizing that flow and optimizing and enforcing the key steps that need to be there, regardless of the underlying tools. And all of that is incorporated into a cloud-based analytics engine, enabling rich insights and comparative metrics into what's going on. It gives you, in essence, a virtual catwalk over the software factory floor, giving you pipeline oversight, traceability, real-time collaboration, enabling the audit and governance in an easy fashion for what's there. That what you use Plutora for is connected in your tool chain. Use us as the measurement tool and the management tool to manage your digital transformation using the practices that Gary has described and are in the book itself. And then you can measure the improvement each step along the way to say, how am I doing now? How do I do compared to previously? How do teams compare between each other? And these metrics, in essence, give you the ability to drill in to find the next constraint and to know the next area to focus on. Next slide. So all of these concepts are part of a bigger bucket of a concept known as value stream management. These delivery pipelines are value streams for the business as software, every enterprise becomes a software company. Value stream management is the effort of monitoring, managing, and improving those software delivery to the customers themselves. There's a wave on this that Forrester's done. Highly recommend getting it. Let's go on though, and I want to focus our time on questions because we've got a few minutes, and this is one of those times of just great insights. So couple quick questions. I visited GaryGruver.com but can't see the code for the book.
The 10 downloads are gone.
Okay.
People have already downloaded, but if you click to the ebook thing and click on that, you get to where you can purchase it, and it's $14.99. Hopefully your company will reimburse you for that fee. And I think I've written four books, and I think this is the best one and has the best information, and it's probably worth the money. And sorry you weren't one of the first 10 to get there.
A couple of quick questions along these lines. There's a question about measuring flow, and what you mentioned a few of them, but what are the most common methods for measuring flow?
I think that's where people have struggled. You'll get, you know, if you look at Nick Kirsten's project to product, he measures story points, and I struggle with that one because it's easy to game the system, and I don't think it's a very reliable flow. Other people look at lines of code trauma because that's what you're writing. Most of the people in the software industry have come to the conclusion that we can't measure productivity because we can't measure flow. And I think it's because everything's a different size or different shape, and we don't want to encourage people to game the system. And that's where I've made the shift, where I can't measure flow and I can't run an experiment and then show that I improved flow because I can't measure it. But but I can measure the waste that's slowing down flow. And that's been my change in focus. And that's a systematic approach that can be taught to everybody in your organization, and they can focus on that systematic approach. And everybody can have a common language for how they do it. And then when you make a change, you can show the waste that you've taken out of the system that was slowing down flow.
Cool. There's a question that just came in that I actually love. It's similar to ones that have been asked. How does one kickstart the DevOps adoption and lead a digital transformation for mainframes and mainframers?
I think that, you know, I would do two things. I would look at this book, and I would go through the steps involved in making your process visible, showing where and how you can build in quality, and then how you can start down the process of changing your process. So you need to make the waste very visible, and you need to make what's possible out there. And then the next thing I would do for a mainframe is I would watch and read anything that Rosalind Radcliffe ever does.
Yep.
I think it was 2016 at the DevOps Enterprise Summit. I think she's one of the best public speakers in this industry in terms of skills of public speaking. And I think her technical knowledge on how to do this on mainframe is outstanding. And she basically, in that presentation, fundamentally tore down what it meant to do DevOps and exactly how to do it on mainframes. And her main point was not mainframes are bad and you can't do DevOps on it. Her main complaint was people are doing DevOps on mainframes the way they did it 30 years ago when they got out of college. And we can't continue to do it that way. We've got to modernize our processes and our approaches for doing mainframe development. And she goes around the world helping her. I had dinner with her a couple times in India last week, and she's continuing to refine that. And saw her present at the DevOps Enterprise Summit, which was very good and effective. And you know, if you're on mainframes and you're not following Rosalind and trying to learn as much as you can from her, shame on you. And I think what I work with a lot of different mainframe types of organizations and what can do here. And, you know, these principles can be applied to large SAP applications. They can be applied to embedded software. They're not just for loosely coupled small teams that can independently develop, qualify, and deploy their code and own that deployment into production. And if you're doing that, you can do a lot of the things that the DevOps industry is talking about. But there's things that you can do to improve the efficiencies of a broad range of applications. And that's what I'm trying to get across in this book, is providing a systematic approach that can be applied across a broad range of applications to drive improvements.
Awesome. there's a question about deciding, you know, there's some high level ideas when you look at flow. Basically, the question is, how do you decide between re-architecting versus automating your deployment versus the orchestration versus just simple process modernization? And when you look at how to improve the flow, how do you, you know, balance all that?
I think that the, you know, the strong recommendation kind of DevOps community is just re-architect, because all the research shows that the teams that are doing DevOps well are loosely coupled teams that can independently develop, qualify, and deploy code in small teams of 5 to 6. And that's great if you can do it. Those teams will be always more efficient. I mean, just think about it. It's pretty obvious. How inefficient can you get with a team of 5 to 7 people? You show me a teams of hundreds of people working together, and I'll show you inefficiencies that you couldn't possibly imagine. But I think in this book and my experience working with a lot of companies, there are things that you can do to dramatically improve the efficiencies of these organizations without a major re-architectural change. And, you know, when I first rolled out this book, I was in Boise. I was presenting to a lot of people that were part of the transformation I led at HP. And I had, you know, everybody raised their hand that was part of it. There were about 30 or 40 people that raised their hand. And I asked, how many people want to do it again? And there wasn't a hand up in the room. those things are hard, challenging, difficult, and there's a lot of easier things that we can be doing to improve the efficiencies and effectiveness of the organization. And then once you have a well-oiled deployment pipeline up and running where you're building in quality, it frees up the capacity to improve your architecture over time. But, you know, having led a major burn the boats, re-architect the whole thing initiative, I'm not sure I'd recommend that to my enemies, and I definitely wouldn't to my friends. If I have a good, stable deployment pipeline up, I can do an evolutionary approach to that architecture change. And there's stuff that I talk about in the book. Maybe we'll cover it in a later webinar. You can either do that by taking something like this, where I've got a, if I've got something like this, where I've got subsystems that I can create, can I do more versioning here and break this coupling between the subsystems? So instead of having 300 people having to work together on an application, can I have three teams of 100? You can either use that approach to continue to break this into smaller systems over time and evolve your architecture, or you can start spinning off microservices, a popular version. And, you know, microservices is probably a cleaner architecture to own long term. But if you're a large organization that's a little more legacy, your operations group may not be ready to handle thousands of microservices, and you may be able to get the benefits as closer by starting to evolve your architecture to break these things up to where these components can be developed and delivered independently. And then when you get to three teams of 100, maybe you break each of those into two teams of 50. And do you go down that path, or do you take this large monolith and start spinning off microservices? You're going to have to look at your specific application and figure out what works best for you. But there are kind of two approaches, but I would say that there's efficiencies that you can gain with a really good structured deployment pipeline with automation in it and start to build in quality that will provide the netting or the protection to enable you to start evolving your architecture over time. And having done major burn the boat re-architectures, I'd avoid that with a passion and try to have an efficient process to where you can do more of an evolutionary approach.
Very cool. This one is a little long, but the net of it is you talked about measuring improvement and you talked about quality and its discovery location. You talked about flow. You didn't mention efficiency really, or cost, and you didn't mention agility. Are those important, not important, interesting? What's your take on all that and other aspects? I guess my add-on question to that was, what other aspects would you have on measuring improvement?
You know, what Goldratt says, and the reason he focuses on the constraint is he's trying to say, I didn't add any more people, I didn't change the number of people I had, and if I kept everybody busy in the factory, I wasn't getting more flow through the organization. And where I've gotten to is to focus on the waste that's slowing things down. And I think what I do is a type of value stream mapping, but it's very specific where I'm looking at, you know, exactly what applications, how they build up. I talk about which environments it flows through, as I don't want something too big and too complex that's hard to manage. So that's one of the pieces. And then the types of waste that I measure and try to capture are the things that we know are slowing down an organization that we know there's technology that enables us to remove once and for all. And we tend to struggle to get people to make that investment and measure that improvement. And I think it's hard to, you know, I can measure the waste, I can measure the delay and feedback. There's in chapter 6, I think, we go into continuous improvement of the product and trying to measure that and applying some of the more concepts that, you know, Jez and Barry and Joanne brought out in Lean Enterprise, where we're, you know, a lot of what we're trying to do is ensure that we're meeting the business objectives of applications, and software is different in that we can continually improve the product. but I'm not sure people are doing an effective job of systemizing that. So the hope is to do that. These are the types of things that I think point out the issues that I see in large organizations. And this is a systematic approach to go after it and measuring these types of things. The building in quality that we did last week is a big part of it, because if you can't build in quality, you can't really change how you run things. And then eventually, once you've moved the bottleneck back over here to where it's the developer, what you need to be doing, and we'll cover this in the planning webinar, is make sure that as you're releasing work into the system, you're not letting excess inventory build up. So whether you call it a Kanban system where developers pull work into it, or you use the theory of constraints, drum, buffer, rope approach, if you can get the constraint on the developer, and then we can focus on anything that we can do to make them more efficient and more effective. And I covered a little bit more of that in chapter 6 of my book, but it's those types of things. And, you know, the thing I will say is that I don't think this is the end all be all answer to a systematic approach to driving continuous improvement of software development. But I do think it is a framework that has been modified to address unique characteristics and capabilities of software. And it's a baseline that can be evolved and improved over time. A lot of what you saw, you know, reported to, you know, either Deming on building in quality, or Goldratt on theory of constraints, or Tiacciono on a culture of continuous improvement, they get, you know, some of the credit in the foundation, but what's there and what's been put in place has been refined and fine-tuned and improved by a broad set of people over years and years. And what I'm hoping here is that this isn't seen as the answer or the final solution, but it's the start of a framework and a conceptual approach that people can apply to a broad set of applications and continue to improve and modify over time to better do what the questioner was trying to ask. This is my best shot at it now, trying to highlight the efficiencies that I see in most large organizations that I go into. There's probably better ways to do this. There's probably better approaches. I'm open to ideas that people might have. And I'm hoping that people take this framework and continue to modify and improvement as we really start to address these sources of waste. And other things are the primary things that are getting in the way of the efficiencies of different organizations.
Cool. There's a question around on the inventory side. You mentioned lines of code. I think, in fact, you had the slide up. Yeah. One question is how best to find lines of code that are inventory, and are there other aspects of just detecting inventory that is at risk?
Well, there's also requirements, right? In this book, I don't go into a lot of detail. I kind of covered that more in Starting Scaling DevOps and Enterprise, but you should really move to a just-in-time breakdown of your requirements, and you should pull those into the system. So you can create a lot of waste and inefficiency in just a huge backlog of requirements in the process. And I covered a little bit in this book, but I think I covered it better in Starting Scaling DevOps and Enterprise. But that's a source of waste. And then here, I think you can go into the Git system and say, you know, diff, you know, how many lines of code turmoil are there between this environment and that environment? Is, you know, I'm not the most technical guy in the world, but when I asked that question to my technical team, they kind of sent me the command line to do the diff. The challenge is going to be making sure that that's visible on an ongoing basis. And that's where it's that. And a lot of these metrics and different types of things I do, I go into organizations and it takes a while to pull them together. And I think a lot of the reasons Plutora is sponsoring this is, if you're going to do this and you want to show this on an ongoing basis, you know, the types of things they do is provide the tools to enable you to pull this out of your systems of record on an ongoing basis, put it in a nice visual view so you can get people across the organization focused on these things.
Excellent. There's a question about your perceptions of the new ITIL V4 and how it relates to flow.
Yeah, I'm not an ITIL guy. You'd probably need to talk to somebody who's much closer to the ITIL processes than I am.
Great. There's a question about getting, and optimizing flow. You mentioned doing a value stream map, looking at the flow and looking at these things. Another question on getting a group behind actually optimizing the flow and getting that started. What's the best way to get started after the book?
I would, follow the book steps. It says make it visible. It's getting it there. It's, what I do is I tend to collect this data. I tend to do this. I run workshops where I'll go in and present the content for like a half a day morning of the content of the book and the types of things to do and how to approach it. Then we'll go in and we'll look at the maps and the waste and the inefficiencies that have been created. And then the team goes through prioritizing the things that they can get done in the next 30 days that'll have the biggest impact on the business. And that gets us going down the path of the Leading the Transformation book, where we're, getting to our mini milestone one, and we have monthly checkpoints and we do that. And as I run workshops, I engage with companies and I get them to identify the biggest sources of waste and then get going on their continuous improvement journey. And I'm there for the first checkpoint, to kick it off. And then I call in once a month and continue to follow up with them. And that gives me a couple of different views. That's one is when they're ready to learn and feeling the pain of an issue, I can help coach them in the right direction. And two, it keeps me current and it helps me understand what is working, what's not working. A lot of organizations, a lot of the leaders in this space will spend time, going in and giving a talk at a company and then leaving. Or some companies will go in and help implement the piece. What I think is unique from my perspective and the way I approach this is I get to see a lot of these different transformations, so I can help people avoid the mistakes that others have made. And I think that has helped refine how I think about and approach these things. And this isn't the perfect answer, but this is what I've found that works. And you say value stream mapping, and the challenge I have is sometimes as people get this way too complex, too hard, I try to get to a picture like this of just how code flows through their environments first. And if I either do that work ahead of time, or if I'm doing a 2-day or a 3-day workshop, what I'll do is I'll stop when I get to the end of, the second webinar we did, which is making the factory visible. And I'll make sure that we've got a very clear view of our deployment pipeline like this before I ever start collecting and putting metrics on it. Because if it's too complex, it's too big and too hard, it's valuable to the people that were in the room that did the value stream map, but it's hard to share outwards. It's hard to share progress over time. And the more you get to a very, very simple flow of how code goes through the system, I found it's much better at showing the waste.
Very cool. One more question on, the Andon cord. Can you talk about how realistic is it to stop all development, and how far do you take the Andon cord concept?
I don't think you use it at all. I think that's a manufacturing thing, because in manufacturing, you stop the process because the process is creating the product. In software, it's very unique in that we don't need to stop the process. We can just gate the bad code and give it back to somebody to get fixed. We don't need to stop the flow. We can use gated commits to make sure that it doesn't make it in the system. We don't need to leave a train wreck laying on the tracks and watching everybody sit around and fix it. We can send the bad code or the bad subsystem back to the person that was creating it, give them an opportunity to fix it. And with this process of gating the code, we never stop the line. That's what I think people are missing in software, is we don't have to stop the line. We just have to stop the bad code. And what we're trying to do with all these quality gates is keep the environments further to the right, more stable, and find and localize the issues as far left as we can, where it's based on a subsystem or application that has a much fewer number of changes to it in the deploy test cycle that enables that triage to be more efficient. So yeah, we don't stop the line in software. We don't have to. I think a lot of people get messed up in that idea. What we do need to do is keep the bad code from moving further down the line, and we can do that with gated commits.
Awesome. This has been great. Gary, fantastic. I'll turn the time over to you, Mitch, since we're out of time.
Well, thank you very much. Thanks to both you, Jeff, and to Gary, and of course, everyone for your excellent questions and the responses from our speakers. So I'd just like to remind everyone the webinar recording and slides will be available. After the webinar, we'll be sending out an email with links to both. You can also check out DevOpsCon, both for this webinar and also to find out upcoming webinars. So please join me in thanking today's speakers, Gary Gruver, President of Gruver Consulting, and Jeff Kies, Director of Product Marketing at Plutora. And of course, we thank Plutora, our sponsor for today's webinar. We'd also like to thank you, our audience, for spending your valuable time with us. It's been my pleasure to host today's webinar for you. Have a great day and be careful out there.